Y ahora tenemos la charla que ustedes no sabían que venía. Que
¡sorpresa!
¡Sorpresa! Tenemos JSON Schema Validation, a dating show between backend and frontend de Jorrik Jorrik no, es frontend developer en Ordina. Las primeras líneas de código de Jorrik fueron en los días en que gobernaba jQuery. Ahora cuenta con más de 5 años de experiencia en frontend usando React y Vue.
Bueno, nos va a explicar cómo la validación de esquemas en JSON puede mejorar la precisión de los datos, simplificar la solución de problemas y acelerar el procesamiento de datos en aplicaciones frontend. Así que un aplauso muy grande para Jorrik.
Thank you. So, good afternoon. And in case I don't see you, good evening and good night or good morning. This is a slightly adjusted quote from the Truman Show I like to start with. My name is Jorrik Klijnsma. I'm a creative front-end developer at Ordina. And I'm going to share something about JSON schema validation. And I'm going to use a dating show analogy for that. So, can I see some hands for people who know what JSON is or already used JSON? See a couple of hands, more and more hands. Are there also people who are already using JSON schemas? Can I also see some hands? A little bit less, but also quite some people. And for the other people, I'm going to show using analogy of a dating show on explaining how a JSON schema, how it works and what it is. And for the people already using it, I'm also going to explain how you can build your TypeScript using JSON schemas and how you can write a script to validate your schemas. So what we're going to do, we're going to have a look at this dating show. We are kind of an internship. We're running backstage and seeing how it goes. And this is the validating show. We are having the possibility to look through the whole process. And this dating show is at first going to select some contestants for the dating show. And we're already like in front of the process where they initially start to get the people and send some forms to check what they want in a partner on the dating show. And then they're coming to the show to have the date on stage, on the show itself. And then after that, the people from the production are going to interview the contestants and see how the date went and if it's a match or not. So first of all, the first part of the process is meeting the contestants. So the production worked really hard on getting the right people and seeing what people would like to join this dating show. And we're going to meet them. They had some interviews up front. And first of all, we're going to have Fiona. Fiona is representing the front end in this case. She is a bit of an artistic woman. She runs an online DIY button store. She's really creative, all about interactions and experiences. And she really loves to go to the theater because she's a person who likes stories and also likes the visual part of stories. And at the theater, that's where she gets the best combination of visual part of a story and the story itself. But Fiona is representing the front end, and we also have a contestant representing the back end, and this is Benny. Benny once held a speed cube world record. He's a really exact guy, really on precise and all about the data and all about science. And like all the back end developers, he loves to look at the clouds to see what shape they have, or he's just interested by the cloud. So they also ask up front to Fiona, so why are you here? Why do you want to participate in this dating show? And Fiona told them she finds it a bit hard to trust a date she would go on to. She's really not sure what she's going to get and always had some weird, unexpected things to happen. Once she got an undefined object, she still has no idea what that object was, and she would like to have a dating show to help her find that right right person for her. They also asked the same question to Benny, and I'm going to take a sip of water, because the humidity is a bit dry here compared to the Netherlands, so having a hard time speak with a dry throat. So this is Benny, and when they ask him, what do you want on this dating show? Why are you here? And Benny thought he's been rejected very often. He was misinterpreted a couple of times and misunderstood. So, for example, once he brought a gift to his date, and he brought some nylon strings for a guitar. But yeah, in the end, she did not want the nylon strings. She wanted a different type of string. So it's always a bit of a hassle getting right, meeting the right expectations. This was more of an introduction, and they asked the two contestants to prepare a date, and here we're going to see the way how this relates to JSON. So Benny, they asked, how would you like your first date to be? So he said, what do I like for a first date? I would like to have some coffee, maybe on a Thursday, because I'm available on Thursday, so if we can have the shoot of the television show, it would be nice to have it on a Thursday. And the goal of his date would be to just show his speed, queue, price, and he's all okay. This is somewhat more like a data structure. So we can turn this into JSON, where we have an array of dates. And here we're going to define what type of date. It's a coffee date, when Thursday, and the goal is 27 in this case, just to represent the 3 × 3 × 3 squares on a Rubik's Cube. So every contestant has this set of what they would like the date to be. But on the other hand, the dates also have some expectations. So here you see expectations of Fiona. So what kind of expectations does she have for a first date? And she would like maybe a restaurant or some coffee. And when would she like to have the shoot for the television show? She would love to have it on a weekday. And when they ask what would your goal of the first date be, her expectations are like no strings attached, just some chit-chatting. This can also be represented in some kind of structure, but this is defining the structure, where we saw with Benny, for every contestant we have the structure, the data itself, but also every contestant has a type of structure on what they want to on what they expect on the date. So here we see the structure of the date. This is basically a JSON schema. So previously we just said what are the types, but that on itself is not a JSON schema. So here you see the JSON schema itself, which has a schema a version. It has a title. It has a type. In this case, it's an object. The object has some properties, which is a date, just an array of dates, and every date consists of an item with what, when, and the goal. So this is easy, but when you have a really large data structure, it might be useful to split it up in different files. So what you are able to do with JSON schemas is you define it like this, and you reference another file. This makes sure you can easily solve the massiveness of your data structure and chop it up in chunks. So this is just a file that you would save as a .json file, and later on you can do all kinds of things with it. This would be the root file, and it's hinting at Fiona's date. That's another JSON file, and what's it doing? It's taking that first root file, and this would be like nested inside that. So this is basically the same as the previous example, only now you are able to use multiple files instead of one really big file with all your data structure in it. So this is really awesome. They have the evening where they're going to shoot the television series, shoot that episode of the dating show. Everyone is arriving, but Benny brought a surprise. And he didn't arrive empty-handed, but yeah, he brought something. He brought a gift, and that was unexpected. He brought a gift, and it was a lovely cat with the name Regex. This was a bit of a problem because yeah, it's a television show. It was not expected, but also can give all kinds of problems. They maybe need someone to take care of animals on set, and they did not prepare that. So this could be a bit of a hassle. Also might have some legal consequence, because maybe they are not even allowed by law to have animals on set without some preparation. So this is a problem. How are they going to solve it? Using JSON schema validation, you have a property. It's called additional properties. And you can turn it on true or on false, and which basically takes care of if you have the data structure. Are you allowed to add different things to your data which you did not encounter for, or did you you can exclude them from being validated or being part of your data set. And then, since the television production team like solved that part on how to deal with additional properties, we also thought, yeah, but we also have some requirements. For example, they do not want people with less than they need contestants to have less than 5 appearances on televisions. They are not looking for people who want to gain a quick fame. So this is a rule they have. Also, they want the contestants to have accepted terms and conditions, and also the relationship status should be a bit okay, so they won't get in trouble with husbands and wives and that kind of hassle. So they also want that covered. So this is what they had as like the data which they want from every contestant. And how would that look in a JSON schema? You just add the required property, where you define the properties of your schema which are required, and then they are mandatory for the data set. That single line, make sure it's in there. So now they were able to start the television episode, like they shoot it, and yeah, Benny and Fiona had a wonderful date. It all went fine. And they just came off camera and they had a small interview with the production team, because they wanted to know, how did it go? Was it the date okay? And did you enjoy it? And they're first going to talk to Fiona, and they wanted to know everything, like I just said. But yeah, mainly they want to know one big thing, and that is Benny your type? Because that's what all the dating is about. So Fiona's has the same question, but she also remembered she already filled them some application form right before she was selected as a contestant, and it would be useful if they could use that initial data where she defined the first date or set the expectations to check afterwards, was this a good date? So then they would be able to create a checklist based on that initial questionnaire, based on the initial form, and that would make it easier to answer at the end of the dating show. So she suggests a system. She says maybe you can automate this whole process, first by starting describing what the contestants need, want, or expect. Then you would retrieve that description, and then create a matching file type for every metric in that description. And when you are saving that metric, like the matching types, then you can share those types afterwards as a checklist to check right after the date, does everything matches. So first of all, this is already what we saw at the beginning. We have the description of what the contestants want. So we can check that off. We also already have the data in some file, so we're going to use a node package file system to just get the file, parse it, so we have the schema imported. With the schema imported, they go to the next step where they want to create a function where they're going to use some type of package. They're going to use two of them, JSON schema to TypeScript node package and a JSON schema package. And with those, they imported it and are creating a function called generate types, where they just validate, compile the schema and save that as a TypeScript object. So now they have the matching type, that the package takes care of that, and now they want to save that type definition. So again, using the same file system, we're going to create a type file called firstDates.d.ts, and they're going to write to that file, and it looks a bit like this. So now they have a type file which they are able to use in their system, so they can check easily, is everything what I need, is it there, is it a match or not? So now this type file you are able to use in your project. They are able to use it in this project, but using the same steps you are also able to get from the description, from your JSON schema, to actual TypeScript. So you have all your front-end code typed based on the schema. So now they have this awesome automation. That works all fine. So they had the interviews with Fiona, they had the interviews with Benny, and now they want to bring them back on stage in the shoot of the episode, where they want to have them combined and chat, was this a good match? With that, they are being interviewed, and it looked okay, like almost all the schemas and types and checks, they all matches between Benny and Fiona. But still some doubting, with all the cameras that's there, like, is it the vibe of the show? Like, what's there that it did not actually click, that it not actually matched? With that, it fades away a bit, like the feeling they got during the date, while they thought about it. And now the production had a problem, because it might not be a good match, because they are still doubting. So they come up with an ID. How can they be sure? They say, let them both think of a first date, and let them have that first date outside of the show, without all the hassle, without all the cameras, and they just have the date and see how that goes. Maybe then it will be a success. So they asked them both to write that date. But I thought, maybe we can also automate the process of making sure the date, the data matches the expectations again. So now we only have defined the schema, but we also want to maybe automate the check of the schema. So for that, we have a bit of the same start. So the show produces creating a script where they use again the same file system to get the main schema. So they get the main schema for the first date expectations Fiona wrote down for their first date after the show. With that, they are also asking Benny, can you prepare this next date? And Benny did so, and he created planned date.json with all the data in there about their first date after the show. With that, they have both set, and now they want to check, does that structure match? So they use, again, an NPM package. It's called AGV, which takes care of that whole process of checking the schema. So they're initiating it by running an AGV compile function, and now they have a validating object, which they are able to use later on to validate stuff. Now they need to see if the structure actually matches. So they create this function where they say, is data success? And they validate like the data they previously gathered. Validate is that object that we saw on the previous slide, which was returned by that HEV NPM package. So now we have all the steps, and in the end, they just want to report the outcome. Like, they've had the date, or they've had it planned, is this a match? So, they're going to just do a console log, just showing, was this a match? Were there any errors? How did it go? So, the automation is done, and they go on a date, but it's a bit of a thing. We need to help Benny a bit, because Benny was figuring out, how can I create this optimal date for Fiona, and he needs all your help. So I've created a poll where there are four dates. And you can scan the QR code and you can pick one of the dates that Benny and Fiona would have to help Benny choose the right date for Fiona. So let's wait a moment. I think I heard we are not able to use the live screen with the results. So I'm going to ask some of you to tell the results at the moment. I already see the results coming in. So we have a date called bungee jumping. We have a haunted house date, where they go to a haunted house. There's a date they could pick as laser tagging, and a date of jet skiing. And everyone scanning the QR code is able to pick one of those four items. I'm going to just wait a little bit longer to give everyone the chance to fill in this this form. And then I'm going to ask some of you to read out loud the state of the poll. So we've waited long enough. Is someone there who has the poll on his screen with the latest results showing? Nobody? Then I'm going to have to read them out loud myself. So at the moment, we have, I think we have the haunted house coming in last place with 20%, even dropping. Then we have the jet skiing, which you all picked with around 20%. Then we have bungee jumping, which is around 23%. And most of you went for laser tagging for the date for Benny and Fiona. So let's see what the results will be. So first of all, we're going to check the haunted house date. We have a console. And when we run the validate function written in the previous script, we're going to run it. And we're going to see what the console log is telling us. So it's checking. Maybe lagging a bit, not sure. Maybe try that again. Well, we run the validation function. It should finish some moment. But I know from a fact that Fiona did not want any Boolean on her date. So the haunted house was not a good item. Hopefully the next one, the validation function will run smoothly. So how did Fiona thought about the bungee jumping date? So again, the same validation function. And when we run the validation function, we're going to see if this does a bit of a better job. She's checking the bungee jumping, but she did not want any strings on the date. And yeah, being a bungee, bit of an elastic string, so that was also not a possibility. So this also failed the validation. Then I think third was the jet skiing date. So let's see how that one went. So again, run the same validation function and see if it indeed was a match. So this unfortunately was no match at all because she did not want any floats in her data. So the last one, the thing you all picked the most was the laser tag date. So was this the day that's gonna save their dating show tragedy or the dating show story? Let's see how the laser check went. So we're running the same validation function, and we're gonna check if the data will work. So it takes a bit of time to check. Yeah, and Fiona did like to have a success where they shoot a lot of arrays. So this was the data that was working. So it's really awesome that you all picked the laser tagging the most. So that made them a success. The data was successful, and the dating show was really happy with the result they had. Two people they brought together, the backend, the frontend, Fiona and Benny. And they manage to find their way of describing the types based on the initial form, and they were also able to validate and automate that that validation. So yeah, it's really awesome. They successfully had their dating show. For that, we want to thank Fiona and Benny. We saw some characters are created by Midjourney, so please give them a small round of applause for being our contestants. And then I want to thank you for being this audience and helping us make this a successful date. So, yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you, and sorry for pronouncing your name wrong 3 times or 4 times. So, do totally we have fine. Any questions here in the room? I think we have questions, but I can't see them.
I don't see.
Do you see one?
Nope.
Okay, I have some questions in here. Mm-hmm. It says, in the...
Okay, two questions there.
Two questions.
One question there.
Hi.
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 Hello. So, if I understood, we need to validate and do all this JSON scheme on our backend, for example, in Node.js or in Python or C Sharp?
So if I get your question right, it's would you be able to use these packages on different types of backend?
Yes, well, I think each language has their own packages to do this JSON scheme and to validate all the JSON between the backend and the frontend.
Yeah. So let me try to answer that where I was using the Node packages, which you, in this case, would be able to use in the frontend. So it, you would be able to check your JSON data, maybe static data, upfront when you build your website or when you're running your development environment, so you know in the end result when you're deploying your website that you have the right data. You could also use that same JSON schemas on the backend side. And I'm not aware of Python or C Sharp or other languages how they incorporate the JSON schema. There should be plenty enough of packages out there for the other languages, but it's mainly people who develop for those packages for those languages to implement this yeah kind of syntax. So yeah.
Okay, more questions here?
So the JSON schema is like a specification and each language implements its own library.
Correct. Yeah. So that's the schema version which you define in the schema where you say this is the way of
okay, so they are mostly community delivered packages.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have a quick question. And what would be your advice for companies that want to implement JSON schemas but are currently very big, very monolithic, and they have to implement them on the front end and back end side? Would you advise to start at some point, or it is too late at this point?
I can find it a bit hard to hear it. Maybe is it possible to repeat the last part?
Yes, if your advice would be that maybe on new microservices to implement those schemas or try to implement them on the whole platform.
So if it's in your code or on the whole platform, is that the
Yeah, my question basically is, would you recommend to use the schemas on each section of the platform, yeah, or just on specific endpoints?
Yeah. Good question. If you would able to, if I would advise to use it on the whole platform or just on certain parts, I think this is really awesome at the moment where you do your build, so you know at build time when stuff is wrong. And I also think, especially the type extraction, And generating the types based on your schema is really helpful in the development environment. So when you're developing locally and in your code base, it's really awesome to have those types of your data set. So I think the moment of building your website or application, that's a really important one, and your development environment locally. Is that an answer to your question?
Yeah. Awesome. And one question. It's recommended to run your data against the JSON schema when you write the data to your database or when you retrieve the information?
So this can be done both. So it can be part of all the steps of where data is coming from. So it can be part of when you retrieve the data and put it inside the database, you are able to check it. But also when you get the data from the database, you would also be able to validate, does this data match what I expect in the front end?
Awesome.
Okay. Yeah. Let's go with the next question there.
Hey, yes, I have two questions. The first one would be to give more context about it. In my company, we're using JSON schema for most of all of our forms, like 70%. And we use dynamic JSON schema, so the users can define the JSON schema, so they can span the data they are storing in our databases. Mm-hmm. So one challenge we faced was basically we needed to validate in the front end in a better with a better UX, right? With these packages like AJV, we have the problem that it validates the whole form in just one pass. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't validate each field separately. So in the front end, if we want a better UX, like validating each field after unchanged, we don't have a library to do that, or I don't know one library that could help us with that. I would like to ask if you know any library like AGV that it's more front end friendly, like to give the user a better user experience. And my second question, to throw it away at the same time, it's basically, when we have forms in our front end and we have selects like dropdowns, those options are not coming from an enum. We don't know the options from advance. So if we want to fetch those options, I don't know if JSON schema has a specific or recommended way to list those options or how we can get those options from an external service or something like that. So I would like to ask you about that, how to get the options like the JSON schema way, and if there is a package that you would recommend for a better UX in the front end.
So I try to answer your first question first. So I think it was about having it per input field and validation. I'm not aware of a package that is able to do that either. One thing that pops up in my mind is just taking the reference files and validating the reference file per input. That might be a solution that suits you. Another thing about the way of validating, the second question was on the... you can repeat the second question in one small sentence.
Yeah, sorry. Basically, we are getting the options from an external service. So how can we get those options and validate those options if we don't know them in advance, like in an enum?
Yeah. So I think when you have a predefined set of options user can select from and you don't know them up front on your client side, what those options gonna be, I think it's handy to check which structure do the options follow. So it might be that you have options which are strings, and maybe you are can be validate the strings as a string, or not have every single option as an enum, but check it more on the structure base instead of every single option. We need to have this specific type of answer. Not sure if you would be able to use that inside of code. So go a bit up higher instead of actual the options. Maybe go to the structure of the options. What type of structure do the options follow?
We have time for one more question.
Can I Okay, thank you. Thank you for the presentation. And my question is, how do you evolve the schema when the specification changes?
Again, it was a bit hard to hear from me, so I'm not sure if you can repeat it. Not sure if you guys have a bit of a head.
Can you hear me better?
Yeah, that's a bit better. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Okay. How do you evolve the schema when the specification changes?
Okay, so this is something where it's kind of a contract which you would be able to use as a contract between backend and frontend. So it is also ensures you have a bit more communication between your frontend. So you just change the schema to agreements you make with the backend, and it also can force you to make sure that the backend is sending the proper agreed upon data. So that's something that I find as a benefit. It's not always possible. In that case, again, I think you need to can be as precise as you can be using the schema to define what you know about the structure. And otherwise, you still have the required and additional properties. So you can say we just allow additional properties. So the backend is able to send over everything. And then you can use what you want to use, but then it also loses a bit of that ability to use it as typed code or, it's losing a bit of that really good solution schema validation is giving you. So, is that answer to your question? Yeah, thank you very much.
Well, I still have like 5 questions, but we have to finish. So a round of applause, and thank you for your work.
Thank you very much. Okay.